Back in October of 2006, a very frightened bishop from Cleveland came to Davenport for the very, very first time. And I landed in Moline, and one of the people in the first contingent to welcome me to the diocese was the then Father Gruss. And we really connected right from the very, very beginning. And he was a master of ceremonies. There were many, many times when we were in the car driving to confirmation someplace. And so I really got to know someone very, very well and became very, very much a friend to me. But I also found someone who had a very deep spiritual life. I found somebody who was extremely pastoral, somebody who was very articulate, and it's somebody who I'm sure we're going to enjoy listening to today. The reason he ended up being invited was Dan Evier was at a conference on stewardship, and a lot of the people from Rapid City, the Diocese of Rapid City, were talking about their bishop and his sense of stewardship. And Dan remembered a homily that Bishop Gruss had given at the cathedral and knew that he was the right person for us today. So I invite you to welcome him as he instructs us on the spirituality of stewardship.
Gotta turn myself on. Good morning. You know, it's thank you for those kind words, Bishop. You almost made me cry.
I lied.
I even cry it when things aren't true. But good morning. It's, you know, it's a delight for me to be back home, really, with all of you for these annual stewardship days. I, you know, see so many of you here from my past, and what state was in my past stays in the past, right? just remember that, some of you. But it's great to be here. Wow, you know. When I was asked to give this address on stewardship by Dan, I remember I got off the phone and the first thoughts that came to my mind were the words of Jesus. Amen, amen, I say to you, no prophet is accepted in his native place. So we'll see what happens, you know, we'll see what happens. But thank you for this warm welcome. I am doing a PowerPoint today. All the beautiful colors that I had on there, they're not showing up very well, but that's all right. The colors are all in your hearts, right? You know, as I think about stewardship, it's something that has really been near and dear to my heart, and it has been for a very long time. Even prior to when I entered the seminary, you know, back during my layperson days, up until now, I continue to grow in this call. I'm continued to be challenged personally in living out this life, living out this call to what I would call not just stewardship, but lively stewardship. There's a difference. There's a difference, I think. And so I continue to struggle sometimes, but I continue to grow in my own call to this lively stewardship. And from my experience in parish ministry, I think that lively stewardship, not just stewardship, but lively stewardship, is the only thing which will bring a tepid community of faith into a vibrant community filled with intentional disciples of Jesus Christ. That's the only thing. And you know, I recall from my own personal experience in parish work how frustrating and difficult it could be at times to get parishioners motivated to really to be true stewards, to be good stewards. And why is that? You know, it's just a lot of different reasons. But you know, I think back to like today, in today's world, the model stewardship diocese is the Diocese of Wichita, really. I mean, but they've been doing it for 40 years and very been intentional and active, but doing it extremely well. But even when I've talked to people from, you know, priests from that diocese, they still say, you know, they still find it challenging to keep people motivated to live this life. To live this life. So, you know, if the church has been preaching or teaching about stewardship for such a long period of time, you know, why hasn't it caught on? Why aren't parishes just fully alive in this life of faithful stewardship? You know, I wish I had all the answers. And I wish I was a prophet among you. But I don't have all the answers. I'm not an expert in creating a stewardship parish. I'm not an expert in creating a stewardship diocese, though my own diocese is in at this moment is in the midst of this, of an intense stewardship process. It's going, I'm not sure how well it's going. It's a challenge. But maybe today I can offer a few comments about what will help, or at least give us some new insights, perhaps in the challenges that we face. And as Bishop said, I've been asked really to speak about stewardship from the spiritual dimension, and so the practical part of it, how you can do it in parishes, I think will be presented later, I'm told. We'll see if this works. The goal for today, in the time I've allotted, there's not enough time, but in the time I've been allotted, I want to accomplish these four things. I want to talk about the biblical origins of stewardship, why stewardship is difficult to live for so many, what is lively stewardship, and the three spirits of stewardship, the three pillars or the three spirits of stewardship. You know, as you saw on that first screen, the title of my presentation is Stewardship Reclaiming Our True Identity. Reclaiming our true identity. I think true stewardship is about reclaiming our true identity. So what is that? Well, I think we have to go back to the Garden of Eden before the fall of Adam and Eve. You know, stewardship is our primordial spirituality. And by that I mean it's the original spirituality of humankind going back to the garden. So I want you to recall in the Garden of Eden when God was creating the world, everything was in perfect harmony. Everything, unity was running throughout every facet of creation. And we hear in the first chapter of the book of Genesis that God created mankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. And God blessed them and said to them, be fertile and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, all the living things that crawl on the earth. And God also said, see, I give you every seed-bearing plant on all the earth and every tree that has seed-bearing fruit on it to be your food. And to all the wild animals, all the birds of the air, all the living creatures that crawl on the earth, I give all the green plants for food. And so it happened. God looked at everything he had made and found it good. Evening came, morning followed the sixth day. And then God rested on the seventh day, and he told us to do the same. Now, God told us to have dominion. That word dominion is an important word. And oftentimes it gets confused with the word domination. You know, dominion, we've been given dominion over all of creation, every aspect of our lives. And this dominion has a different meaning than we might expect. And I think it lays the foundation for all of life and all of ministry. Dominion in the Hebrew word is rada. Say that, rada. Very good. This is a royal word. This is the dominating rule of a king. But the word must be understood in the context of an entire command that God gives to the first couple in the book of Genesis, in verses 27 and 28. In verse 27, he tells us that God creates human beings in God's image and likeness, and according to in his image and according to God's likeness. And then God calls upon men and women to exercise rada, or dominion over all of creation. So what does this look like? Verse 27, a dominion that is in the image and likeness of God. Now let's think about the kind of king that God desires. The same word, rada, is used in the psalm, in Psalm number 72, which was originally a coronation psalm for Solomon. And in verse 8 of that psalm, we read, may he have dominion, or rada, from sea to sea. And then in verses 12 to 14 of the psalm, we see that this dominion, we see what this Rada looks like. He delivers the needy when they call, the poor and those who have no helper. He has pity on the weak and the needy and saves the lives of the needy. From oppression and violence, he redeems their life, and precious is their blood in his sight. That sounds very different than domination, no? Very different than domination. So this is the dominion in the eyes of God, because it's the dominion which comes from the very heart of God himself. You know, as we know, God does not exploit or dominate or consume anything recklessly. God does not use his power to hurt, but he uses it rather to heal. God values what cannot be replaced. God works to preserve life. He works to preserve creation, not to destroy it. So the dominion that God desires for us means that you and I, we are called to protect what God has created. We are called to manage that which God belongs to God. We are called to be responsible for that which God has entrusted to our care. You and I, we are called to practice dominion, not domination. And friends, this is our primordial spirituality. This is the beginning of stewardship. I think reclaiming our true identity means reclaiming our true spirituality. So why is stewardship difficult for so many to live, even many in our among our regular parishioners? Why is stewardship such a challenge in our parishes? Why is it such a challenge to live out a life of stewardship in our families? I think for a couple of reasons. First of all, we have a new religion of today, and it's called secularism. God has been replaced as the center of the universe. You know, so often life, I think, is lived in this way. This might be the mindset that, well, I can manage very nicely without God, right? I can manage very nicely without God, except when I'm desperate or I need something from him, huh? Don't you think that's usury? That's usury, really. Is that an appropriate relationship with one that loves us more than we can imagine? God has been replaced as the center of the universe by man. Man is now the center of the universe, and the new religion today, I think, is secularism. And as you see, the core values of secularism are very prominent in our world today. Just think about it. Materialism, hedonism, individualism, consumerism, relativism. In other words, what's happening, there's this unbridled ego within us that's taken over. Life is about what I can get out of it to make me happy. Huh? What I can get out of life to make me happy instead of what I can put into it to make it and me better and more holy. Well, how did this happen? I think it's happened gradually over a long period of time. It's like the boiling frog syndrome. You ever hear of the boiling frog syndrome? They say if you put a frog into a pot of boiling water, it'll leap out right away to escape the danger. But if you put a frog in a kettle that is filled with water that's nice and cool and pleasant and relaxing, and then you gradually turn up the heat until the water starts boiling, the frog will not become aware of the threat until it's too late. And by then he will be unable to jump out of the water, because the frog's survival instincts are geared toward detecting sudden changes. So what killed the frog? His own ability or inability to decide to jump out of the water. You know, at one point he no longer had the strength to jump out. He used all his energy in helping its body to adjust to the increase in the water temperature. I mean, I don't know if this is true or if it's a myth. I've never put a frog in nice water, pleasant water, and then turned up the heat. So maybe you want to try that yourself, and you'll see if this is accurate. But, you know, obviously this is a metaphor of how a slow, gradual change can lead to eventual undesirable consequences. And I think this is the case in the Christian world today, and what we see regarding the impact our culture has on a Christian way of life, and the way in which people are choosing to live their Christian faith. You know, we live in a world today, I think, is in time of great change. As you know, religion and faith are under a severe attack. Our society and our culture is growing cold to religion. Even people who identify themselves as Christians want to live their Christian life with all their options open. So they seek to manage their own life instead of living a life of discipleship. They look at Jesus as, well, he's an ethical model. He's a nice philosopher. He was a good teacher. He's a generous man who, you know, has a heart for the poor. And, you know, some people say they would rather take a walk around a lake and look at the ducks and the turtles than say a bunch of prayers in a building. This is where our culture is today. You know, one of the fastest growing groups in the world are the nuns. Not like Sister Judy, where is she? Not like this N-U-N-S, but the N-O-N-E-S, the nuns. It's a category of people who have disassociated themselves with any religious denomination. You know, they could have been baptized and raised Catholic, but now they don't associate at all with any faith denomination, any religion, period. And you know, I recently read some statistics on this. 50% of Catholics who leave the church classify themselves in this category as nuns. 50% of Catholics today who have left the church call themselves nuns, and not the good kind. You know, Pope Benedict once said, that the Jesus that makes everything okay for everybody is a phantom. It's a dream, it's not a real figure. The Jesus of the Gospels, the Jesus that the Catholic Church preaches is, by contrast, demanding and bold. He said, if Jesus was really accepting and tolerant of all things and toward all people, do you think he really would have ended up being murdered on a cross? Think about that. The second reason why people are not living this primordial spirituality as God's stewards, which one could also identify or name lively faith or intentional discipleship, is because of threats. These are just two threats I'm going to identify today. The first one is Christianity has been redefined. Christianity for many people has been diminished to merely being a good person, doing the right thing, or doing nice things for other people. But as you and I know, at the heart of Christianity is the cross of Jesus Christ. I don't know where that says anything about being a nice person. It's the cross of Jesus Christ, which you and I are all called to embrace fully in our lives. So in today's world, the meaning of the cross, I think, or our call to embrace it, has diminished or even disappeared. Because people don't want to suffer. People don't want to live a life of sacrifice. And it's hard to do when the new religion is secularism. Live a life of sacrifice. The second threat, I think, you know, we have a whole parish of people who have been sacramentalized, but not evangelized. You know, there are people who have received the sacraments, but they are not on fire. They're not on fire with the Holy Spirit. They're not on fire for their faith. The good news of Jesus Christ has not hit them yet. They are still pre-Pentecost people, pre-Pentecost Catholics. And I think many in our parishes who are at Mass on Sundays fit this description. Faithful churchgoers are not evangelizing their children. And I think it's because these people, they lack the primacy of a relationship with Jesus Christ where their hearts have been truly awakened. Now, do you have an awakened heart? An awakened heart. You know, when I meet with kids prior to confirmation, and I ask them, how many of you are bored? I meet with them like an hour before the confirmation for about 40 minutes. And I ask them about how many of you are bored during Mass, and like, I'm not kidding, 85% or more raise their hands. There's something wrong with that. It's because they don't understand what's happening at Mass is the problem. They've never heard that every sacramental moment, every time we participate in the sacrament, it's a personal, intimate encounter with Jesus himself. Most Catholics don't know this. The best kept Catholic secret we have, unfortunately, and it's to the demise of the church. So either they've never been told this, or they don't pay attention, but they do lack the primacy of a relationship with Jesus. You know, they know about Jesus, but they don't know Jesus personally. A lot of our people are that way. They know about Jesus, but they don't know him personally and intimately. That's the problem. That is the main problem in my mind. That is the main problem in the church today. Pope Francis continually speaks about asking for this renewed, daily, personal, intimate encounter with Christ. How many of you got up this morning and asked the Lord for a new, renewed, personal encounter with Jesus today? We should put tape something on the mirror in the bathroom every morning so we can see that. Lord Jesus, give me a renewed, personal, intimate encounter with you today. Huh? That's the problem. Archbishop Reno Fisichella, he's the head of the Pontifical Council for the Promotion of the New Evangelization. He puts it this way. He says, faith has become like smoldering cinders or embers that's been weakened by sin and secularism. And he said, it must be reawakened, fanned into flame. And we must help Christians to encounter once again this Jesus, especially those who have left the church. But I also think it's especially those sitting in the pews in your churches every Sunday as well. You know, when we think about stewardship, I think there's a misconception to what it is in the minds of so many people. Many of your parishioners think it's this, money. It's not money. It has nothing to do with money. Absolutely nothing to do with money. It has everything to do with the cross of Jesus Christ. If we want to live a life of lively stewardship, we have to embrace. That's the only way, is embracing the cross of Jesus. That's the only way. You know, it's stewardship is a call to embrace the cross of Jesus every day. I mean, he says, if you wish to be my disciples, you must deny yourself daily and pick up your cross and follow. You know, in other words, daily sacrifices. This is a daily sacrifice. His cross is still alive today. You know, the fruits of that is still alive, but it came from sacrifices. So lively faith or lively stewardship is about a relationship, I think, that has claimed one's life. It's about this I-thou relationship that in some way, has claimed my heart. In other words, my desire deep in my own heart is to be with the one who is filling me every day. It's why I get out of bed in the morning. I don't get out of bed in the morning to go to work. I get out of bed in the morning so that I can be filled anew with the love and mercy of God. You know, where faith is not alive, our relationship with the Lord is a means to something else, whatever that might be. You know, so lively stewardship or lively faith or lively discipleship first begins with this relationship of intimacy, where Jesus has truly claimed our hearts, truly claimed our hearts. You know, so lively stewardship happens not up here, but here in the heart. Lively faith happens in the heart. I mean, if we look at the Catechism of the Catholic Church, we find this quote or this paragraph: the heart is our hidden center, where the grasp of our reason beyond the grasp of our reason and of others. Only the Spirit of God can fathom the human heart and know it fully. The heart is a place of decision, deeper than our psychic drives. It's a place of truth where we choose life or death. It's a place of encounter, because as image of God, we live in relation. It's a place of covenant. So lively discipleship, I think, is the fruit of a lived experience of God's intimate and personal love within one's heart. And you know, my brother pastors, priests, the first duty of a pastor is to lead people to a deep intimacy with this Trinitarian love. The first duty of a pastor is to lead people to a heart-to-heart, close relationship with the Trinity. And if it hasn't happened in our own hearts, if it hasn't happened in the heart of a priest or a pastor, it will be very difficult to lead others to it. You know, Pope Francis, or Pope Benedict said, the faithful expect one thing from their priests, one thing, that they be specialists in promoting this encounter between God and man, that you be specialists in doing this. So it's first about an intimate relationship, which leads me to discover my true identity, because God reveals it to me in that intimate unity, in that intimate encounter. And then he sends me on a mission as his disciple. And because my heart is awakened, because my heart is longing for him, then I freely choose to go on mission. Because I believe in my heart of hearts, and I trust in my heart of hearts in this God who has intimately loved me. You know, let me share my own thing. You know, back when I was in my late 20s, I think, I was still flying airplanes for a living, and I went on a search for God because my life was miserable. And I began to pray daily for this lived experience of God's love for me, because I had always heard in catechism, oh, God loves you, God loves you, God's love. What does that mean, really? What does that really mean? And so I began to pray for this lived experience of that. If this is true, I want this lived experience of it, of this love. And as time went on, I didn't have some dramatic, you know, eschatological experience at all. But I began to realize the depth of Christ's love for me. And in spite of my great sinfulness, you know, something was changing in my heart. In reality, I was praying for an awakening and wanting this new lived experience of his love. I was praying for an awakening. And I began to realize that all that I am, all that I have, all that I ever hope to be is a result of God's love, nothing else, a result of God's love. And once this became heart knowledge and not head knowledge, then I was free. I was free to live my life for the Lord. And that's what's led me to the seminary, and it's really what's led me to this moment being in front of you today. You know, think about your spouse. When you fell in love with your spouse, when you were falling in love with your spouse, wasn't like something in your heart happening, right? Wasn't your heart being awakened in some way to the point where you wanted to give your life away forever, right? There was an awakening of your heart. Well, when we fall in love with someone, our hearts become awakened. So my heart became awakened, and this I-thou relationship claimed my heart, and my life has never been the same. Because, you know, this is our true identity. This is our true identity. This was the true identity of Adam and Eve before the fall. And I think it will be difficult to live an authentic life of stewardship without this awakening. Because, you know what, we hold back, or we don't want to engage fully. We might want to go so far, what's comfortable for us. But is the cross comfortable? No, it's not. And when we do that, we don't live our true identity. You know, Jesus came to restore us to our true identity, to restore us to true stewards, dominion, not domination. He came to restore us to our original spirituality. And you know, before we became disciples, we were called to be stewards. Stewardship is, I think, in some way, our restoration. It's our way out. You know, when we think of stewardship, we must see it as at the very heart of Catholic spirituality. It's at the heart of what makes us disciples. It's a way of living life in the Holy Spirit. It's a way of living life in the Holy Spirit. It's a way of being alive in the Holy Spirit. You know, are you alive in the Holy Spirit? Do you pray every day for the Spirit comes alive and all the gifts you've been given in the Holy Spirit and the fruits of the Spirit come alive in your heart? Do you pray that every day? Why not? It won't happen if you don't pray for it, right? It won't. I guarantee you it won't. It won't happen if we're not praying for it and praying for it daily. Daily. You know, in the pastoral letter on stewardship, a disciple's response, how many of you read this? How many of you prayed with this and studied this? You should have parish groups reading and praying and studying with this. Forget the Bible study. That can come later. Start with this, because this is a Bible study. Truly, it is. This is a Bible study. So you should, if you want your parishes to become stewardship parishes, this is the foundational document. And if you haven't read it, you should be reading it and praying with it and studying it. It will change your heart. It'll tell you what stewardship really, really is all about. And it will inspire you. It will also challenge you, which is a good thing. It's a good thing. Well, in the disciples' response, stewardship is so intimately connected to discipleship. They can't be separated. Becoming a disciple of Jesus naturally leads to the practice of stewardship if we're a true disciple of Jesus, giving our lives away for others. You know, having dominion, not domination. It's what we do after we say, I believe. You know, this is mature discipleship. Mature discipleship. Mature disciples make a conscious, firm decision. Conscious, firm decision that's carried out in actions to be followers of Jesus Christ, no matter what the cost might be. Each of us, clergy, religious, laypersons, married, single, adult, child, has a personal vocation. And God intends each of us to play a unique role in carrying out His divine plan. I think the challenge then is to understand our role, our vocation, and then to respond generously to this call from God. Christian vocation entails the practice of stewardship. This is an awakened heart, an awakened heart. Another way I might want to interpret this for you is to say that in a Catholic parish, the idea of volunteerism should not exist. Volunteers connotes that we can choose to share our time and talents and treasure, or we can choose not to. Volunteerism means there's a beginning to something and an end to something, right? For Christians, though, the only choice we have is whether we want to live out our baptismal call, our life in Christ, no matter what our age might be. The laity are active, or called to be active, collaborators in the priesthood of Jesus, sharing in His saving work. So friends, it's not about volunteering. It's about discipleship. In true stewardship parishes, there are no such thing as volunteers. Only disciples. Only disciples. You know, think about this. Your moms, how many of you moms? Raise your hand. Your moms can't wake up one morning and say, well, I think I'm going to be a volunteer today. Right? Because being a mom is intrinsic to who a mom is. Living stewardship is intrinsic to who a disciple is. So, no. Who? So, no matter what age we are, by virtue of baptism in Jesus, we're called, challenged, invited, you put the word in there, to a lifestyle of stewardship in the heart of Jesus. What's happening here? Am I going the wrong way? Oh, I wanted to get back to the cross. That's what I wanted to do. It comes natural for me. Okay, there we go. You know, stewardship is planned giving. It doesn't leave any giving to chance. And I think it challenges us to plan. And not just to plan, but to prioritize. It asks you and me to appraise in a very deliberate way what we're going to do with our time and our talent and treasure. Think about that now. There's nothing in that that says anything about volunteerism. It's not about money, as I showed you earlier, but it comes from this active personal relationship, not only with Jesus, but with one another. So at the heart of it all, it's spiritual. It's not a program or an event. It's a spirituality that has to be lived as such. And the commitment to stewardship is expressed not in a single action or a series of actions. It's not a program, but it's an entire way of life. It means seriously committing our lives to the Lord, seriously committing. It doesn't matter if I'm a layperson or the bishop or a priest or, you know, the Lord invites each and every one of us to commit our lives to Him every single day in a very conscious and intentional way. And I have to say, friends, if we're not deeply praying every day, if we're not consciously committing to follow Jesus every day, then it will be difficult to live a life of stewardship. And most likely we won't. We won't. And stewardship, because it's a spirituality, it's an expression of discipleship with the power, think about this, with the power to change how we understand and live out our lives. Because God, as we know, is the origin of all life. God is the giver of all freedom. God is the source of all things. And you and I, we're merely the recipients and called to be the caretakers of such tremendous gifts given to us. And because God has entrusted care, us with the care of creation, because God has entrusted all of us with this care, each one of us will be called to give an account one day in how we have managed what the Master has given to us. You know, recall the gospel of the talents. You all know that gospel. And what happened to the one servant who buried his talent? What happened to that, to him? If we are disciples of Jesus, I mean, I don't know that you can be a volunteer for Jesus. Can you be a volunteer for Jesus? If we are disciples of Jesus, not volunteers, then we are grateful for the gifts we received, and then we're very, very eager to use them to show our love for God and for one another. Wonderful author, C.S. Lewis, in Mere Christianity, he wrote this. He said, every faculty you have, your power of thinking or moving your limbs from moment to moment is given to you by God. He said, if you devoted every moment of your whole life exclusively to His service, you could not give Him anything that was not, in a sense, His own already. Think about that. In other words, it's all God's in the first place. So we don't have to live autonomously anymore. We don't have to live autonomously anymore. If we live in this truth, then we have true freedom. If we live in this truth, then we will be living our true identity. If not in the things of this world, the things in our lives will possess us. They'll possess us. And when things possess us, instead of God possessing us, you and I, we are not free in Christ. We are not free in Christ. Okay? Finally, I want to talk about the spirituality of stewardship and put it within the context of these three pillars or spirits of stewardship. And these come, they're not my own, I didn't create this. In the church you steal everything from everybody and represent it in your own way. But these come from a presentation I attended on stewardship a couple years ago by a Father Darren Gurr, and I just felt they were important. They made sense to me in reclaiming our identity. So the first one is a spirit of gratitude, the spirit of generosity, and the spirit of trust. So we're going to go through these one by one, and I'll try to move through these quickly. You know, the spirit of gratitude, it is so hard to live here. Why? Because I believe it's hard because we live in an entitlement culture. And every single one of us are affected by this vice, what I'm going to call the vice of entitlement. Every single one of us are affected by it. You know, your kids feel entitled, right? Maybe you don't see that, but if you don't believe it, how do they respond to you when you say no, right? There's a sense of entitlement if they respond in a negative way, you know? What happens when you don't get your way? Do you become frustrated and irritated? Would you suspect that might come out of an entitlement mentality? Well, I'm entitled to have my way, you know? Or someone's driving down the highway a little slower than you want to drive, and you're honking the horn, it's almost like road rage. You're getting upset and flustered and all of that because they're driving too slow. I got to get someplace fast. And you get mad. Don't you think you're feeling entitled to go over the speed limit? You don't think about it in those terms, but that's what's happening. There's an entitlement mentality that's become part of our fallen nature, I think. You know, it's part of our fallen nature. And it's because if we're not getting our way or having our way, we become frustrated and irritated. So in the moment, if I'm living in a spirit of gratitude, I won't be frustrated. I won't be irritated by the circumstances of life because my heart is resting in the Lord. And at the heart of the Lord is gratitude. But I think the challenges in living out the spirit of gratitude come from these two things. So these are just two. There's many more, but I don't have time for all of them. One is a rampant consumerism. You know, we feel unfulfilled, and we want more. I mean, you can reflect in your own life about this. I don't know. I mean, you can let God reveal whatever is He wants to reveal to you regarding these things. But we feel entitled to more. What we have doesn't seem to be good enough. And you know, the whole marketing strategy in our culture today is all about this. It makes the consumer unsettled, right? How many of you went out and got the iPhone 6 because it was something new? Did you need that? Huh? I mean, it's just one little bitty example. The consumer world, you know, the marketing people, they make the consumer feel unsettled. And then, so therefore, the consumer now has to have the latest and the greatest. And we keep massing things and goods and things and goods and things and goods. You know, people are even renting storage units to put all their stuff in, right? Now, is that serving them any purpose in life? Is sitting in a locked storage, you know, garage someplace, and they're paying $100 a month for rent or whatever it is. I don't know but that's, you know, that's the rampant consumerism. The other one is radical individualism. You know, we come to a sense of personal survival in our culture. In other words, success has become independent from God and very dependent upon me. And, you know, there may be a narrow sense of gratitude in the sense it might be, well, I'm grateful for what I've accomplished. So God's been kind of left out of the equation. You know, in other words, we kind of manage our lives, we manage things on our own. It's this self-management. We're all very good at it. At least I am. I can tell you that. Stewardship spirituality lets us reclaim the spirit of gratitude. In other words, that God is sustaining and blessing all of our gifts and all of our talents, all of our fortunes in life. Gratitude allows us to see the good things, the blessings in ourselves, which include those hidden talents we don't want to look at because we don't think they're good enough. But gratitude also lets us see them and others as well. And it leads to a whole new engagement, I think, with the world. When we truly live in gratitude for what we have, truly live in gratitude, then we desire less. We desire less. And not only that, we'll be willing to give more away, more of our time and talents and treasure. We're willing to sacrifice more for the sake of others. You know, if you think about it, gratitude is at the heart of the Eucharist. It's at the very heart of Jesus, in relationship to the Father. You know, the beginning of the preface, we hear these words every Sunday. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. Think about these words. It's truly right and just, our duty and our salvation. These words are important. These words are important. Living in a spirit of gratitude, I believe, instantly connects us to the Father and His love for us. Gratitude helps restore the primordial spirituality. It helps us to reclaim our true identity. Okay? Now, how about the spirit of generosity? Because we have lost this primordial spirituality, we've lost the spirit of generosity. Or at least in some ways, perhaps it's been compromised. Why? Simply put, one word. It's really big here because I did that intentionally. Because it's big. It's big. There's a fear of running out. We can't be generous because there's a fear of running out. There's a fear that I perhaps may not have enough. I'm frightened about the future. What if I run out? Then what will I do? If I give more, will I have enough left? I mean, think about this. This is how people process their generosity. Perhaps people have been burned in the past. I don't know. And now they're very cautious. But you know, think about this. Fear and faith, they are incompatible with each other. Fear and faith are incompatible. Because if I live in fear, then I'm not living in faith. If I live in faith, I have no fears whatsoever. If I'm truly living in faith, I have no fear. You know, so to not live a life of stewardship, I believe it's a faith issue. If a person isn't living a life of lively stewardship, it's a faith issue. You know, recall when Jesus called Peter out of the boat. You know that gospel story, right? Jesus was walking on the water, and Peter sees them and recognizes it's Jesus, and Jesus invites him out of the boat to come to him. Well, when Peter kept his gaze on the Lord, think about this. When he kept his gaze on Jesus, he could do what Jesus could do, the seemingly impossible. He could walk on water. Huh? He was doing what Jesus can do. When he turned his attention to himself, to the waves, to the wind, he became frightened and beginning to sink. He cried out, Lord, Lord, save me. And the Lord Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying, Oh, Peter, you of little faith, why did you doubt? You of little faith, why did you give in to fear? So friends, if I'm living in faith, I have no fear of running out. If I live in faith, I have no fear of not having enough. If I live in faith, I'm not afraid of suffering. If I live in faith, I will provide, I will always live in gratitude and in generosity, trusting that God will always provide. You know, I don't know that we think about this enough, but you know, I believe God feels responsible for us. Do you ever think about that? God feels responsible for you and for me. Even though we're sinners, he feels responsible for us. God will never, ever be outdone in generosity. He will always take care of us. And he's invited you and me, each of us, into his way of life. He's invited us into his way of being. He's invited us into his way of generosity. You know, so when we live in the spirit of generosity, we live in the image of God, the very image of God in whom we've been created. And it's our true identity. When we live in this spirit of generosity, we look and act just like God. Think about that. Generosity gives us the ultimate meaning of life. And when we're generous with our time and our talent and our treasure, then we realize just how much we actually have. And it's far more than what we thought we had. Generosity puts what we are about into the proper order. In the proper order, living a generous life sets us free. Sets us free. We're no longer possessed by what we have, and therefore we're free to give it away. It fills us, generosity fills us, not with secular happiness, but with true, everlasting Christian joy. And true generosity means we don't give because there's a need. I mean, if you give to your church because you think there's a need for it, that's not stewardship, first of all. True generosity means we don't give because there's a need, but because fundamentally it's who we are, as created in God's image and likeness. It's our true identity in the image and the likeness of God. So choosing to live in the spirit of generosity helps us to reclaim our true identity. Okay? Now about the spirit of trust. It perhaps might be the greatest challenge of the three, I think. Living in the spirit of trust requires living in the present moment. We don't live in the present moment very well. But stewardship in general requires us to live in the present moment. Stewardship is living in the present moment. You know, so much of our lives are lived in the future, right? Don't you think? Our consumeristic society helps us to live in the future. We get up, we go to work. Why? So we can get paid. Why? So that we can save for the future. We spend a lot of time preparing and worrying about the future. You know, for example, this is just one little example, you know, like, cancer runs in my family. You know, my father had it, my mother, a lot of my relatives did. And so we worry about if it's going to show up in our lives or heart problems or whatever it might be. You know, we're always thinking about what's coming next. I mean, even now you might be thinking, well, yeah, I wish he'd get off the stage so I can move on to the next thing. Or you're thinking about, what am I going to do tonight or next week or these things at this list. You know, you always have a list. You know, people put a list on their cell phones. So this is living in the future. Living in the spirit of trust is also difficult because we're forever living in the past. You know, when we think of the past and how it might creep up on us again. In other words, something of the past, perhaps like an illness or some bad luck or something, we think in our heads, you know, oh, this is going to repeat itself. I know it is. I know it is. And this truly robs us of the present. So we don't step out in faith. You know, if we're living in the past or the future, we're not living faithfully. We're not living in faith, period. Stewardship is God in the present. He is in the now. The kingdom of God is among you. The kingdom of God is in our midst. It's now, right? So when we live in the now, we have what we need. When we live in the now, we're directly lined up with God because God is in the now. If we live in the present, we will always have all we need now. You know, Mother Teresa, God bless her, I can't wait till she's canonized a saint. But she said, you know, she said, the day I take your nest egg is the day I lose hold of Jesus. The day I take your nest egg is the day I lose hold of Jesus. You know, Mother Teresa, she always lived in the now. When the Lord asked her to do something or start some new ministry or whatever, and she never worried about where the money was going to come from for her ministry, never. She lived in the spirit of trust, and God never let her down. And if the money didn't come, then for her it was God's way of saying to her, this is not my will. And she accepted that. So living in the spirit of trust helps us to reclaim our true identity, because trust, like faith, keeps us from living in fear. The kingdom of God is in our midst. So I believe these three pillars are really the heartbeat of the disciple. And Jesus longs to restore us to our true identity. So I'm going to summarize. You know, our true identity comes from being created in God's image and likeness, not from what you have, what you do, or anything else. And it comes from embracing the life Jesus has not only modeled for us, but has called us to live.
Pope Francis, God bless him, you know, in the very second paragraph of the Joy of the Gospel, he wrote this. The great danger in today's world, pervaded as it is by consumerism, is the desolation and the anguish born of a complacent yet covetous heart, the feverish pursuit of frivolous pleasures and a blunted conscience. He says, whenever our interior life becomes caught up in its own self-interest and concerns, he said, then there's no longer room for others. There's no place for the poor. God's voice is no longer heard. The quiet joy of his love is no longer felt, and the desire to do good fades. And he goes on to say, this is a very real danger for believers too. He said, many fall prey to it. They end up resentful and angry and listless. And he said, this is no way to live a dignified and fulfilled life. He said, it is not God's will for us, nor is it the life and the Holy Spirit which has its source in the heart of the risen Christ. You know, C.S. Lewis wrote, he said, a person whose hands are full of parcels cannot receive a gift. And I think today, as I've been saying, one of the spiritual evils facing our world is the growing materialist consumerism. When we hold tightly to the material possessions, then one cannot receive the spiritual gifts that God wishes to give his beloved children. When we hold on to things, then we're not free to receive God's spiritual gifts, which are far more important, as you know. You know, God transforms a steward beyond mere kindness and volunteerism to a love of sacrifice and detachment, enabling the steward to continually receive God's gifts. When a steward loves God above treasured earthly possessions, whatever those might be, could be time, talent, and treasure, then God provides, if we love God above these things, then God provides the grace for the steward to love at an even greater depth so that they can become as generous as God. And this depth of love is growth in holiness. And this is one of the joyful rewards of a stewardship way of life. Our world has offered you comfort, but as Pope Benedict says, God has made each and every one of you for greatness. God has made us for greatness. He sent Jesus to heal us and to lead us. He sent him to lead us as individuals, as parish communities, as a nation, as a world. He sent Jesus to lead us to that greatness. Jesus Christ is the true foundation of the stewardship way of life. It begins and ends with him. And it's only an awakened heart that will convince a person to embrace a life of lively stewardship and to lead one to reclaim their true identity. If you want to grow in a stewardship way of life, if you want your parish to grow in a stewardship way of life, if you want to reclaim your true identity, it begins and ends in that daily personal intimate encounter with the God who has given you everything, and then leading others to that encounter so that they can reclaim their true identity. Now finally, I want to say something about the Eucharist, which is what really, the Eucharist is what teaches us the way of stewardship. You know, the Eucharist is a great sign and agent of charity. When you and I come together to participate and partake of this greatest act of charity, we participate in the very stewardship of Jesus himself. The Lord has given us all that he has, his very self in totality, in completeness, in wholeness. And our participation in this act of charity, this act of stewardship, the Eucharist, implies that we bring all that we have. It implies that we bring all that we are, which is all that God's given to us. And we unite ourselves in these tremendous gifts and blessings through Christ's saving sacrifice. And then, having received from this very altar of love, having received from Christ's own stewardship, if this celebration is to be sincere, if it is to be thorough, then it will lead each of us to living out our true identity as a faithful steward, a steward uniquely his own, but united in one body through Jesus Christ. Stewardship transforms lives because of its love, and it's in this transformation process and conversion journey towards love that gives life, new life to the church. So, as St. Luke says, if you wish to come after me, you must deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. For if you wish to save your life, you will lose it. But if you lose your life for my sake, you will save it. Thank you, and God bless you.
Quickly, since we were ahead of schedule, for once a bishop ended on time, or actually early. But because of that, we do have some time for questions. So let me, if you have a question for Bishop Gruss, let me bring the mic to you. We'll take about 10 minutes if you have a question that you can address. I'm just going to put the microphone to your face and don't raise your hand.
You got a question right here.
You know, I do have a difficult time not worrying about the future financially because, you know, I have my little nest egg and I'm very guarding of that. So it's kind of the opposite of what you were saying.
That is the opposite of what I was saying.
I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but the good news is Jesus wants you to be free of that. And so when we cling to those things, you know, if we have to, first of all, we have to believe in the depths of our hearts that no matter what, God is going to provide for us. You know, we're not entitled to a certain lifestyle, even though we think we are. We're entitled to salvation through the cross of Jesus. That's the only entitlement we have. And so oftentimes people, you're not the lone stranger in this. People protect their nest eggs because they're entitled to it. They feel they are. They feel they're entitled. I've worked my whole life for this. I deserve, which is entitlement word, I deserve a certain lifestyle as I've been living my whole life. But then the focus, when we live life that way, then the focus is on that and it's not on Jesus. I mean, that's ultimately the end. That's the end. It's our focus is not on the Lord. You know, I think John Wesley, he talked about in the beginning of his life and ministry, he would tithe 10% of whatever he made to the church. And by the time he retired and went into retirement, he was tithing 90% and living off 10. Because we're called to live simple lives, not extravagant lives. We're called to that. And simple lives, Mother Teresa lived simply so others may live simply, or simply live. You know, so I think, you know, that's very common. But I think it's asking Jesus, okay, Lord, I have this nest egg, and I'm afraid. And so part of the relationship is telling Jesus, I'm afraid I won't make it if I give more away. So you're sharing your heart, what's in your heart, this fear, and inviting Jesus to be in it with you. Lord, be with me in this fear that I have of not having enough. Give me the grace to trust you more. So again, it talks about, you know, this relationship with Jesus is not about just necessarily this prayer time, but it's about entering in a true intimate relationship with them and sharing what's in the depths of our hearts, all of our concerns and worries, and asking him to be with us in them so that he can transform, you know, to live and think, to worry about what I might not have in the future, in the Lord's mind, I think, is stinking thinking. Because it means we're not trusting. It means I'm not trusting him. I'm not trusting that he will provide. That's what it means. You know, and I'm not condemning him. That's what it means. It means I'm not trusting him that no matter what, the Lord is going to take care of me.
That's living in deep faith, and that's living in the spirit of trust, that regardless of what happens, you know, I know if I'm even put on the street and have to live in a tent, Lord, I know you're going to be with me there. And that's perhaps the cross when we're called to live. You know, who knows? But, you know, it's how do we live daily in faith and in trust and in gratitude? Because if we're living in fear, we're not living in faith. That's the only way to say it. If I'm living in fear, I'm not living in faith. If I'm living in deeply in faith, I don't have fears. Yes, I would like this and this and this. I'd like this lifestyle and this lifestyle. I'd like to be able to afford this and this. But, you know, I'm not entitled to that. Why would I be entitled to that? You know, I'm entitled to Christ's love. That's what I'm entitled to. And everything else, if we're living in faith, it goes by the wayside. We don't worry as much. It doesn't mean the worry's going to go away. But you can, the worry can, as we bring these fears to the Lord in prayer, then the fears begin to diminish. And we start living more in faith.
Well, I really, really appreciate everything you're saying and you're talking, but isn't there a little bit of responsibility that a person takes to plan for the future? Even though you're, and be a good Christian with Christ at the same time, because
I would agree, because that's being a good steward of what God has given to you.
Right.
Okay, but to live in the future all the time, worrying about we have to manage what the Lord has given to us, and planning for our future, what we think might be our future, is important, because that's managing an appropriate way, in a stewardship way of what God, but to hoard it and never be generous with it, that's not a life in Jesus. That's a very selfish life. So it's how we manage and what we do with it once we've sort of kind of planned out. You know, so if we give God this much and we hold back and keep this much, that's not a life of a steward. That's a life of a selfish person. They're concerned more about themselves than having dominion, which is taking, as we saw, taking care of the poor, the vulnerable, and so on and so forth. That's really living the gospel mission, that dominion is really living the gospel mission.
Thank you, Bishop. I really could resonate. Right here. I could really resonate with what you talked about throughout the whole. And it's been my experience, the more I've prayed for that gift of generosity, and it's been my experience, the more generous I become, the more generous to become. It generates the Lord. I mean, the Lord generates it. And he also takes away that fear then. And yes, we do need to be good stewards, but that's how I've also prayed. Let me be a good steward. Let my husband and I be a good steward of what you've provided. Because he's provided, as you said, he's provided it all anyway. And so the more I grow in my faith and trust in him, the more he wants, in a sense, wants me to give.
Right.
And it just is growing. It's just a growing
process. Right. No, it's spot on. It's a life of stewardship, reclaiming your true identity is a process. Because just think about how far we've gotten away from our true identity, right? The years, you know, the boiling frog, right? You know, it takes time to reclaim it. We don't just wake up one day and all of a sudden, no, I have this deep faith and I'm going to surrender everything and give all I have to the poor. That's not going to happen. It takes time in prayer to reclaim this identity.
Bishop, at our church, and I assume it's the same in everyone else's, the stewardship lives very strong in seniors. You have more time, you have more resources to give and everything else. We have trouble reaching the middle generation, especially in our church. We can have three or four generations going to our church at the same time. And they're used to mom and dad doing everything, and you know, they're grown-ups now, but they go to church with mom and dad, and they may not even contribute financially because mom and dad's doing the financial part of it. So how do we reach this center generation to tell them what you're saying? Is there a key phrase, is there something we can do to reach that center generation?
You teach them how to engage a serious personal relationship with Jesus. It's only going to happen when we have an awakened heart. And our churches are filled with people who don't have an awakened heart. They don't volunteer. They come to Mass and that is it. They might put in their $5 in the collection basket every week. That's it. They don't have an awakened heart. You know, so that's the whole thing. That's, I think, as part of the pastor's responsibility is to help lead people to how to pray and how to cultivate this awakened heart. You know? And that's the only way it's going to happen. It's the only way. Unless a person has an awakened heart, they're not going to let go of the things they claim as their own. It's simple as that. I mean, at least that's my own personal experience. You know, it wasn't until my heart was awakened that I would give more than a dollar in the collection basket. And I felt good about myself. There's a lot of people in your pews are like that. They might put $5 in this because this is now 30 years later. So, and they feel good about themselves. And, you know, but it's because I think it's helping people come to an awakened heart, you know, and teaching them and letting them know this is a, if they really want to be the disciple Jesus is calling them to, it only comes through this awakened heart in Him. That's the only way it's going to happen. That's the only way it's going to happen. So it's teaching people how to encounter the Lord.
Mr. Gruss?
Where are you?
Back here. Okay. Thank you for your teaching today. One of your fellow bishops, Bishop Arnaud of Green Bay, came up with a curriculum for stewardship. He called it the 12 Gardens of Stewardship, which includes not only the financial topics, but the stewardship of relationships, the stewardship of God's creation, the stewardship of, and the point being is our diocese has recently adopted that curriculum for our schools and parish programs, but for the lady who talked about reaching that middle generation, this curriculum is really for a lifelong process of ongoing faith formation. And I would just like your comment on and support on using tools to teach better stewardship. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm not familiar with that curriculum, so I can't really comment on that. But I think any way in which we can engage regular people in the pews to think about and pray about and reflect upon what stewardship really is. You know, I told all my priests in the parish, in my parishes, they need to buy a copy of this book and give it to every family in their parish. Maybe they will read it, maybe they won't, I don't know. But at least it says a couple of things. That one, this is important if the pastor is putting it in the hands of every family. But it also says that the diocese is serious about promoting a lifestyle of stewardship. And that's what I said, you know, you could have study groups in your parishes using this and invite people to come, but put it in their hands first. I don't even know if this is in print anymore.
It is. It's online fully.
You can get it online for free. I don't know how many pages you have to print off, but or you can print it off and take it down to your local printer and probably get it cheaper than when you can buy it or a finished product like this. But I think, you know, this is came from the U.S. Conference of Catholic Bishops, so this is what the church teaches about stewardship. But anyway, you know, the curriculum is great. I don't know what it's about, but any way that you can put things in the hands of people to make them begin to think, you know, it's the Lord who converts hearts. You know, so the Lord can convert the hearts of people if they have this, I think. If they begin to read it, they might see their life in a new way and their relationship, their faith in a new way. That's all we can do. You know, you can lead a horse to water, right? But if you never lead them to water, then they're never going to know they're thirsty. Right? So anything you can do. We've lost a couple of generations of serious Catholics, I think, And so to try to reclaim them, you know, to help them to come back or help them to see their life. They said 50% of Catholics who have left the church consider themselves as nuns. That's not a good thing.
And when only 25% or less of people of Catholics going to Mass on a regular basis, you know, so that's 75% of Catholics, you know, are out there. And so it's really, this is can be part of the new evangelization as well.
Bishop, what specifically awakened you? You talked about your awakened heart, and I know you said you were, you know, this happened when you were considering a vocation to priesthood, but...
Before that, even.
Okay.
Yeah, I was flying for a living. I moved to Davenport. I was here a year. The job I hated. I hated it. It was the worst job. I flew the traffic watch in the Quad Cities. It was the most boring job I ever had in my life. I prayed the engine to quit so I could land on a par 5 hole in any of the golf courses around the Quad City area. And so after the first year, the contract was not renewed. And so I was miserable. And I was also broke. I was losing money in this proposition big time. And so by the end, my savings was gone. I was unhappy. And I was a lazy Catholic, too. That was part of it. And that's what I began to think about. Okay, something's wrong with this picture. If this is going to be the way the rest of my life is, there's something wrong here. If God really loves me, I shouldn't be feeling this way. And so I determined the problem was not God, it was me. I wasn't serious about my faith. And so, as I said earlier, you know, I began to pray, you know, because I was told in religious ed, every single class I've ever been in, oh, God loves you, God loves you, God loves you. What in the world does that mean? What does that look like? What does that feel like, you know? I know what love feels like. I know what God's love feels like. So that's why I began to pray for a lived experience of God's love for me personally. And that was my prayer for a long time. And I began to see all of a sudden my life changing. I got back in a serious way into the sacramental life of the church. I began to see myself differently, the church differently, other people differently. And then as time went on, my prayer shifted from that, because I was getting that, to, Lord, just tell me what you want me to do with the rest of my life, and I'll do it. So there was a surrender. So this awakened heart really leads us to a deep surrender to the Lord, to whatever His will might be. Well, yeah, I was baptized Catholic, you know, and went to Catholic schools through 8th grade, and, you know, so yeah, the seeds of faith were there, but, you know, sometimes because of our lack, we don't cultivate them. And I think that's part of the problem with our church today, that the seeds of faith are there, but they're not cultivated. They're not being cultivated. They're not cultivated within individuals themselves. Individuals are doing nothing or very little to cultivate those seeds. So, you know, relationship with the Lord is up to us. And, you know, no one can force us into this relationship. You know, Christ certainly isn't going to force us into it. He's always going to welcome us back with open arms, no matter how far we've strayed. But He's not going to force us to. But when we say yes to that, with a true interior desire, look out. Your life will change in ways you have no idea. You can't imagine. But obviously, that's the good news. You know, it'll be very profound, and it'll bring meaning to your life. It did to me anyway, that I would have never envisioned. I mean, I think about this. This 30 years ago, I was miserable. 35 years ago, miserable flying airplanes. And now I'm the Bishop of Rapid City. Now think about that. I mean, doesn't it sound a little bizarre? But, you know, it does, I think. I think about that regularly, but it's with deep gratitude. You know, what the Lord has done for my life is done in my life, and that's where He's led me. And I think it goes back to, because I was lost, now I am found. And I begin to pray for this every day, this lived experience of His love. And now I pray for this new outpouring of the Holy Spirit in my life. You know, stir up the gifts every day, Lord, that I can use them, you know, to serve You and Your church. So that's what we have to do. If we're serious disciples, then those are the prayers we want to pray every day. Lord, stir up these gifts of the Holy Spirit You've given to me. You know, pour out a new Pentecost on this diocese. I pray that continually. Every year, we do a novena to the Holy Spirit 9 days before the Feast of Pentecost across the whole diocese. Unbelievable what things are happening. And I think a part of it is because of that. people are serious about, because I invite them to something more. That's the whole thing. It's inviting people to something more than what they currently have. That's what sharing faith is about. You know, and if we're not willing to share our own personal faith and our own personal love for Jesus, then we're not living our faith. You know, Jesus converted disciples. Jesus drew disciples not because he taught church doctrine. It was only because he shared his deep love and union with the Father with people. That's what attracted people. And so when we share our faith with others and our deep love for the Lord with others, that can become a contagion. Because people see, wow, this person's happy all the time. He's joyful all the time. He's alive. I want that. Well, ask for it. If you want it, ask for it. It's not rocket science, folks. It's not rocket science. The Lord is generous, you know. He cares for us. He cares about us. You know, he feels responsible for us. We have to believe that. And when we really believe it, not up here, it's not just nice words, when we truly believe it here, then it has the potential to transform everything. It'll turn everything upside down, but in a good way. So, all right. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Let's give a round of applause.
Great to be here.
Our next speaker is a fellow that I became acquainted with last fall in Chicago at the ICSC conference. ICSC is International Catholic Stewardship Council, and they have an annual conference. And I happened to go to this workshop that was very intriguing to me about everyday stewardship, that Tracy Welliver was the presenter. It really resonated with me because that's a topic much in line with what Bishop Gruss said this morning about God calling us every day in the normal events of our lives. Tracy has his book here today for sale, and I happened to get one at that conference, and I've read it from cover to cover. And I feel like I really know him better than he knows me, because a lot of the reflections in his book come from his daily life. He tells about his children and his wife and his ministry. And so I think I know him quite well, and I'm just so excited to have him here today. Tracy is a writer, a speaker. He's worked many, many years in the area of stewardship, helping parishes with stewardship and gifts discernment and engagement tools. For over 20 years, he was a pastoral minister at St. Pius X in Greensboro, North Carolina. And Pius X won the Primo Award that ICSC offers every year to parishes doing outstanding stewardship back in 2009, and Tracy was on the parish staff at the time. So I'm sure he was pretty engaged in the life of the parish and their efforts in that regard. He is now with Liturgical Publications as Director of Parish Community and Engagement. And so would you please help me welcome Tracy Welliver.
Thank you. Well, good afternoon, everybody. I am very honored to be with you. Very honored to be with you today, all the way from Greensboro, North Carolina. You know, our company is based in Wisconsin, and it was just a couple of years ago when LPI called me up and said, you know, they were looking to have someone, you know, start something in the company where we were going to do consulting with parishes and with dioceses and things like that. And would I be interested? And, you know, I never really anticipated leaving parish ministry, but after 22 years, I guess it's what God called me to do. So I said, I would love to do that. And then they said, would you be interested in moving to Wisconsin? And I said, I would not love to do that. So I impressed upon them that, you know, it's the world of technology allows us to work wherever we are. And they said, okay, yeah, you can stay in North Carolina, which is fine because I spend at least half of my life on the road anyway, traveling around, talking to
wonderful folks like you guys. And, you know, stewardship is my passion. It wasn't always my passion. You know, I mean, I have to admit, I have 2 degrees in theology. Stewardship wasn't mentioned very often. And if it was, we talked about stewardship of God's creation. So if someone were to ask me 25 years ago, what is stewardship? I would have said, that must be recycling cans and bottles, right? But it was my experience in the parish that truly helped to begin my formation in this way of life. And I oftentimes say that that formation began one day with my pastor walking in the church, and a man came up and said, Father Frank, I want to let you know that the pew second from the front is broken, the kneeler is broken. And my expectation was that Father Frank would say something like, well, we're going to go ahead and get that taken care of, thanks for letting me know. But he turns to this man and he says, well, then I think you should go fix it. And I was like, wow, that's pretty bold. And Cal was like, well, okay, maybe I'll come by tomorrow. Well, Cal, for the next several years, became the handyman at the parish and literally did everything. But, you know, it began that day, and what began that day was this education that stewardship is about belonging. It's about giving of one's gifts, and that in the parish community, right, it's not just a place where we go to church on a Sunday. It is our family, right? And much like the bishop said this morning, in terms of moms, you don't get up in the morning and say, I'm going to volunteer to be a mom, right? I mean, you don't volunteer your time to your children. You don't make contributions or donations to your children. You do what is called of you. And your parish is a family. And what we do there is what we are called to do. And so some time ago, Dan and Sister Laura called me up and asked me to come here and speak today. And they wanted me to speak about, you know, some of the practical aspects of stewardship at a parish. And, you know, I was like, wow, you know, that'd be great. I mean, it's a whole lot of stuff. You know, how much time do I have? And they said about an hour. And I was like, yeah, an hour. You know, because literally, I mean, we could, like, be here for several days talking about all the different aspects. So what we're going to attempt to do is doing a whole lot. Thank you, Dan, and thank you, God, for a little bit extra time this afternoon. And we're going to go through cultivating stewardship in the parish community, some practical tips and tools for living the stewardship way of life. And I've chosen 2 ways to help organize the talk this morning. The first way is we're going to look at Charles Zeck's book, Best Practices in Parish Stewardship. And what he has in his book, how many people are familiar with this book? Okay? It's a key book that you should get. You know, go on Amazon, order from our Sunday visitor. But, you know, Charles Zeck is a professor and researcher at Villanova University, the home of the national champions. Who beat Carolina. My son is a sophomore at Carolina. He texted me, he said, Dad, this was literally one of the worst nights of my life. He said, I'm never gonna go through this again. And I felt bad for him, and I was pulling for him, but I did go to Duke University, so I only felt bad for about an hour, and that was done, okay? We're going to use what Charles Zeck came up with in his research in terms of 8 things that parishes can do to advance stewardship, okay? Now you don't have to like write this down real quick because this slide is going to appear, well, at least 8 times, okay? We're gonna go back to it over and over again. We're gonna go through all eight of these, okay? And we're gonna make some comments and present some additional information. The other way we're going to actually order this talk is through some memes I created. Who knows what a meme is? Okay? So, you know, it's those blocks, right, on Facebook. They have those really cute sayings and, like, pictures of cats and stuff like that. You know, in preparation for this, I was like, oh, this is a really great idea. I'm going to make these memes. And I had to turn to my 12-year-old, and I said, Zach, you know those things, those pictures with the words, right, you know, on Facebook? So, yeah. I said, those are memes, right? He's like, yeah. I said, okay, I just want to make sure. He goes, you weren't sure how to pronounce it, were you? And I said, oh, you know, I knew. He goes, all you old people say, like, memes and stuff like that, don't you? And I said, no, not me. Not me. I'm cool, Zach. I'm cool, okay? I wanted to make sure you were cool, too, okay? So we have some memes. And what's going to happen is at the end of the day today, I'm going to upload this to my website, and so you can download the entire presentation, okay? That is not to say that you should stop taking notes, because as a catechist for over 20 years, I know that if you take notes, you'll remember it a whole lot better. So let's go to number one, being a welcoming parish that takes community building seriously, okay? A welcoming parish that takes community building seriously. And so for meme number one, we have, it's kind of hard because it's not too bright, but this says, hospitality is not about more donuts. Okay? Because, you know, oftentimes, you know, I work with parishes all over the country. And invariably, you know, at least 60 to 75%. So do you guys have a welcoming community? Do you have hospitality? We have donuts after Mass. Yeah. And when they think about, you know, well, what else can we do to be more hospitable? We can have more donuts after Mass. You know, we can go from one Sunday to two Sundays a month, you know? And, you know, like my wife would say, my wife actually, this is the only one she saw of anyone I was putting together, and she loves donuts. And so she said, oh, come on, it is a little bit about donuts, right? I said, well, yeah, you know, kinda, you know? But, you know, it's about so much more than that. And so one of the things that I do going around the country is, you know, you collect things that parishes are doing. So let's talk about, oh, wait, before I get to that, here's my friend. Does anybody know who this is? This is Mickey Mouse. Now, why would Mickey Mouse make an entrance like that in a presentation like this? Who here has ever been to Disney World or Disneyland? Okay, they like to claim it's the happiest place on earth. I don't know if that's true. But you know, they certainly try. And how do they try? They roll out the red carpet for you. And everyone has smiles, and everyone wants to help you, and everyone's there at your beck and call. You know, they try to keep the place clean and just, I mean, it's just such a great experience. Well, the reality is, it's not the happiest place on earth. And if you have the joy of the Lord in your heart, you need to communicate where the happiest place on earth is. And on no given Sunday should someone have a greater sense of hospitality or be welcomed more warmly at Disneyland or Disney World than they should in your own parish community. Because when I show up at Disneyland or Disney World, they want me to have a great experience and to come back again. They want me to spend a lot of money. When someone comes to the parish on a Sunday, even if they've never been there before, you're not selling anything, but you're offering the good news of Jesus Christ. And so here are some ways that parishes around the country, you can think about what your own parish, what you do, some of just things that people are doing, right? You know, ministers of hospitality at all the entrances. You know, opening and closing doors, shaking hands. How many people here are familiar with the book Rebuilt? Okay? So Father Tom White, you know, when he began his journey in his parish to a more engaged parish, he and his associate went to a large evangelical megachurch. And he went to the entrance, and there was somebody there with a big smile and shook his hand, you know, and just, hey, how are you? You know, what's your name? Blah, 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 goes on in. And then he goes back out of the church, and he goes to another entrance. And his associate says, what are you doing? And he says, I want to test this. I want to see if this happens at every single door I'm going in. And it did. And he said, this is one thing we have to bring back to our parish. You know, my my parish, we built a new church and dedicated it about 5 years ago. On the day of the dedication, my pastor, about 20 minutes before the bishop and everyone were to process in, no one's in there, just he and I, and he says, go to the sacristy and get a toolkit, take off all of the door stops on the doors. I said, we just got them put on there. I mean, literally like 2 or 3 days ago. He's like, I know, but take them off. No one's coming into this church without having the door open for them and someone shaking their hand. Yeah. That experience of being welcomed, being treated as priest, prophet, and king as you arrive at the door of the house of God. Walking people to their seats. You know, some parishes are actually doing this. Everyone loves at a wedding, you know, oh, look at this, I'm being escorted, you know. And so some parishes are like, hey, why can't we do that? Maybe not all the time, maybe once in a while. Why don't we, like, can we do that on a Sunday? I mean, you want to see the face of a little old lady and a 16-year-old boy walking her to her seat? You want to see that? That's awesome. That's awesome. So a lot of parishes use teenagers to do escorting. That's really cool. Materials for visitors and welcome kits for newcomers, right? So, yes, our parishes are family, but, you know, people come to visit our family. So that's the one thing that's different between the parish family and my media family. You know, I'm going to go home tomorrow, and I'm going to have dinner with my family. I hope to goodness people I don't know are just going to walk in my door and sit down at the table. It's like, who are you? Well, I'm just visiting, you know. It's a little weird. But in a parish, right? Because the meal is different. Because the meal is being offered not just for us and the family, but is being offered for all those who seek. And these people come in the door. You know, maybe they've come in for the first time. Maybe they've come in for the first time in 20 years, right? So you have something for them, you have something for visitors, something that engages them, welcome kits for newcomers, these things which tell people what your community is about and why they should be happy to be there. Yeah. Information booths after masses. You know, for most of the people in this room, most of the people in this room are the most engaged people in their parish community, right? The actively disengaged people do not come to the stewardship day for the diocese, right? I mean, they're not doing that, right? And so sometimes the most engaged people, they think everyone knows what they know. And the reality is there's some people here that they know so much. 90% of the people in the pews, they don't have any idea what you know, right? So an information booth, maybe after a mass, gives permission for someone to ask a question. You know, they're not going to come up and just ask anybody randomly, but you're standing right there. You know, you're like in your psychiatry booth. You're like Lucy, you know, waiting for Charlie Brown, right? You know, come on, ask me a question. New member dinners and events. Now, this is key in terms of stewardship, right? Because it's not just about hospitality. But what parishes oftentimes do, and this is a great idea, is when you have gatherings for new members, okay? And, you know, some parishes, they invite everybody. Some parishes, they just have it, you know, a special event, whatever. Whatever fits the character and personality of your community. But what's really great about it is you have an opportunity not just to be welcoming, but to impart the stewardship message and say, this is what our parish is about. Not only that, but this is what our expectation is of those who belong here. You know, accountability is not something to be scared about, right? Accountability is what makes families and communities stronger, right? I have accountability with my children. They have accountability with me. There's no accountability, whatever, right? You know, in the church, we say, hey, this is the way of life that we have embarked upon. We hope that you can buy into that and journey with us. Neighborhood gatherings, you know, greater hospitality, sometimes breaking up the community into neighborhoods, into zip codes where you live, okay? Think about what you do. We don't really have the time this morning to break it open, you know? But if you have a particularly good idea, you know, something you do that really works well, you know, always be willing to share that idea with others, you know. Always remember this, hospitality is not something we do, it is something that we are, right? Just as stewardship is not a series of actions, it's a way of life, hospitality is not just a bunch of things that we implement, it is how we are as a people. Okay, let's go back to then to Charles Zeck, number two. Things that parishes can do to advance stewardship, appoint a stewardship counselor committee. Now, hopefully, all the parishes represented here have stewardship committees. But that's not always the case. I mean, sometimes, you know, parishes say, well, we're going to have parish council take care of this. Oh, we're just going to have the staff take care of this. Well, you know, Charles Zeck has some things to say about that. And that's going to be the next slide. But first, my meme. You ready? Because this goes for any stewardship committee or any other committee, because this happens in the church all the time, doesn't it? Here we go. Excuse me, what does this committee do anyway? And it says, Marvin waited his silence as the group searched for an answer. Right? I don't know, what do? You know? And sometimes this does happen with stewardship committees, right? Because stewardship committees a lot of times make it their business to do what? Run commitment campaigns and ministry fairs. And when it's over, they say, well, what do we do now? Well, you know why? You know why that happens? Because that's not the main thing. You know, we say, keep the main thing, and that's the main thing. And the main thing is always Jesus, right? And so I oftentimes say, hey, guess what? Jesus never held a ministry fair. Did you ever read about that Jesus ministry fair in the Bible? I didn't see that one. No boards, none of that stuff. Not to say that's not vitally important. Great tool, great instrument, but it's not the main thing. So a stewardship committee is about so much more within a 12-month period, right? I mean, essentially, a stewardship committee is helping to be the guardians of the stewardship message, or helping to proclaim that message, you know? 12 months out of the year. And what Charles Zeck's research found, effects on parish stewardship for standalone bodies, right? It's for anybody who's thinking, well, we're not gonna have a specific stewardship committee. You know, I'm on staff, I'll just do it myself, right? Standalone bodies in a parish, generally 22% more in treasure, 7% more in time given, 20% more in outreach time. Now, Charles Zeck isn't saying how or why that happens. He's just saying, I'm telling you, that's what happens, right? Effects on parish stewardship for bodies folded into parish finance councils. You know? We already heard this morning, you know, this isn't about money. So what parishes sometimes do is say, well, you know, stewardship committee will be the finance council. 5% decrease in outreach. May mean, I don't know, you might get a bump in an offertory, but people totally miss the message, right? So a standalone stewardship committee, right? Stewardship committee that's focused on the true message of stewardship, which will come up in some of these other numbers. But to end with this, involvement in this activity was the only catechetical formational event alone that had significant impact on more than one stewardship outcome measure, okay? And for Charles Zeck, he has time, talent, treasure, and he has outreach. So he has four. His research shows, if you only do one thing, okay? His research shows if you have to do a whole bunch of things together, okay? In terms of catechizing and presenting the message for it to have a real profound effect. But only one thing, if you only did one thing, would have that effect. Does anyone have any idea what that would be? It's a crazy thing. I don't even believe it myself, but I can't fight the numbers. Attending the annual ICSC conference. It's crazy. And why do you think that is? The reason it is because that's where you get all the good ideas. Like the bishop already said this morning, you know, he had this one slide and he said, oh, you know, I stole that. Like I say in stewardship, you know, good stewardship starts in a parish. You go find other parishes and you steal all the stuff they're doing. That's what you're supposed to do. I mean, if you're spending a whole lot of time inventing the wheel, well, I maybe didn't hear. The wheel already exists. You know, go find someone, you know? Okay? So invest. Make an investment in people. Send people to the conference. Send people to stewardship days like this. Okay? Stewardship committee. Number three, include stewardship as a vital component of the parish plan. Well, this is an interesting thing to say. And why is that? Because working with parishes all around the country, guess what I find? A whole lot of parishes, they don't have a parish plan. So how can you make a vital component of something that doesn't exist? Yikes. And so here's our next meme. If you don't know where you are going, you'll end up someplace else. Yogi Berra, right? That's your sign on the road. Traveling along, you go one way or the other way, and both of them are not good, okay? So let me share with you some basic components of a plan. And this is whether you're making a pastoral plan, a stewardship plan. This is basic planning in general, right? Because you have to have a plan. Where you were yesterday, where you are today, where you're going to be in the future, God willing. All right? So right off the bat, five steps. You have to know what is the size of your community, okay? I can't imagine implementing stewardship in a community and say, you know what, we're going to see, you know, how this raises engagement, but we really don't know how many people are in our parish. I go into parishes all the time and I say, well, you know, how many households do you have? They say 3,000. I said, how many people are attending on a Sunday? Well, all our masses combined, it's about 1,300. Well, yeah. You don't have 3,000 households. That's what's on the list. Yeah, well, you know, some of those people are dead. Some of those people moved away. Some of those people haven't set foot in the parish in 10 years. You have to have an accurate idea of who is in your community. Right? What is the history of your community? Right? I came to St. Pius X about 25 years ago, right? I was there 22 years. When I came, our parish was talking about stewardship and implementing things about stewardship for over two decades. I can't go in there and say, hey, I heard this great stuff. Let's do this. And they're like, excuse me, we have been doing that. You know? You have to have a sense of history, where your community has come from, things that people that have gone before you. Okay? What is the makeup of your community? You know, what's the median age of your community? Okay? What's the average family size? Zip codes. You know, what's happening in this country, and I tell this people all the time because, you know, I want parishes to really take seriously what they're doing in their communities and engaging people. What's happening in the country all over the place, good stewardship parishes, they're vibrant. They have lots of people doing lots of things, and things are going so well. And leading so many people to Jesus Christ. And somebody goes to that parish, they have such a profound experience, and we live in a transient society, don't we? And you move a lot, you get transferred or whatever, and then you move to another location. Those people will move, they will search high and low for a parish similar to that. And they will be willing to travel 45 minutes to an hour to go to church on Sunday to find that parish community. And the reason why that's so important is because as they go to that parish community, they pass by maybe five or six others. And I hate to say it, you know, actually I don't call myself a consultant, but I call myself a coach. You go into a parish and I have to be honest, I have to say, hey, based upon these demographics, based upon the fact that 90% of your parish is only from the zip code that you are located in, 30, 40 years from now, I may come back, you may not be here. I don't want that to be the case, right? I don't want that to be the case. So, important data. Two more, what works and what is broken, right? Ministries, programs, outreach. Particularly in stewardship, right? You're going to make a plan. You want people to you know, give of their gifts and their talents. And you want them to give them to gifts, their gifts and talents to ministries that are working. Right? You can't say that a ministry is broken and not working and all it needs is just more gifts and talents. No, maybe there's something there. So you need to explore that. Okay? And last is, what is going on around you, right? What is your diocese saying about the growth in your area, you know? Is somebody going to build a plant right next to you and there's like hundreds of people going to be coming to your parish that are new? You know, is your stewardship committee ready and mobilized to use all those gifts and talents? Three principles. We'll go through real quick. Everyone has a place in the table, right? Their feedback, their money, or their dreams. In terms of stewardship, right? Everyone has gifts. I do a talk on giftedness and gift discernment. You know, and I'm a strengths coach, so I use Strengths Finder in parishes. And if you were to take your top five strengths that you get in that assessment, and you were to find someone else with the same top five, right? The first number is, you have to look through, it's like 447,000. But if you were to take the top 10, it's 1 through 34, just the top 10, to find somebody else with that same number, those same in that same order, it's something like 300 trillion, right? More than all the people on the earth. The message is that each and every one of us has been created by God with unique gifts. And therefore, that means every single one of us has something to give that's very unique. No more of this, someone will do that. You know, one of the most difficult things we do in parishes is, right, with catechesis and things, faith formation is about to start up. And even in some of the best stewardship parishes, it's 2 weeks before. Hi, I'm the DRE, I'm Tracy. I just wanted to say to everybody, you know, we just need three more catechists. Even if you've never been a catechist before in your whole life, even if you don't even like children, we'll help you. We'll give you a book, we'll give you training. It'll be fine, right? I mean, come on. We do that, don't we? They may not even have the gifts for that, right? Can you imagine? Excuse me, my car is broken down. Do you know how to fix it? No, but I will do the best I can and that will be enough. No, it won't be. I won't be able to go anywhere. Okay? Everyone has a place at the table. There will be another plan after this one, right? And so you put together an annual stewardship plan. Okay? You want to have goals that are concrete, realistic, and measurable. Because guess what? You're going to have a plan next year, right? Your plan can't be, this year we are going to have an increase of engaged parishioners, more people involved in ministries by like 200%. You know, what are you, nuts? Come on. Set a goal that you could reach, because you're going to set another goal and another goal. Have a plan for the plan, right? You know, particularly with pastoral plans. We're talking about, you know, having stewardship as an important part of a parish plan. Well, that's great. Except then if you create the plan, you have to have a plan to execute the plan. Or what happens? It becomes a written document on a shelf. Let's go to number four. The fourth thing that parishes can do to advance stewardship: emphasize stewardship in all parish formation programs. Okay, so that's everywhere. Now let's take a look at our meme. Oh, this is Ken the Koala. Ken the Koala, see, I'm having a hard time seeing because it's not really bright, but Ken the Koala freezes upon hearing about God's call to be generous. See, look at that. He's like, am I supposed to spit out this eucalyptus and share it now? No, you don't want to share that. Come on. Right? Poor Ken the Koala, you know? He believed he was accumulating all this great stuff for him. And someone said, oh, you know what? I have a better way. I have a better way to not be attached to that stuff and to give it away. You know, give what away? Just a little bit? No, give it all away. You know, we talk about... you know, what it is that we are to give. A lot of times we talk about tithing, right? I mean, Father Andrew Kimberling, if you're familiar with him, okay? He's from, well, not anymore, but he was at the parish of St. Thomas More in Centennial, Colorado. Right? And he talks an awful lot, he gives a lot of talks about tithing, how important it is to talk about a tithe. Except that you don't want to miss the message, right? Because the message is never, what do I give to God? 10%. That's not the message. Because for Ken the koala, if it means 10%, that means 90% of all the eucalyptus leaves are just for him. 90%. That's a good deal. Right? Is that a good deal? No. What's the percentage? It's 100%. It's 100%. You know, I love God with my whole heart, my mind, and my soul. I give everything. Everything. So, how do we do this? I mean, first of all, the message, right, from the bishop's pastoral letter, and I was just saying, I was saying to Dan during the lunch, because we were talking about the bishop's talk this morning. You know, I've been involved in stewardship for quite some time and speaking at conferences and things like that. And I always ask about the bishop's pastoral letter. You know, who's read it? And unfortunately, most people haven't read it. But at the same time, even when I hear people talk about the message in the bishop's pastoral letter, very, very rarely does the understanding of mature discipleship pop up. And the bishop brought it up today, and I was back there, yeah, that's awesome, okay? Because so oftentimes, the way we communicate this message doesn't come through because sometimes we're not communicating the fullness of the message. Three convictions in the bishop's pastoral letter, okay? The first one they label the challenge, and that is that mature discipleship requires a decision to follow Jesus Christ no matter the cost, right? I mean, when you begin to understand that it's about maturity and it's about the call today that I will receive, I respond no matter the cost. And you know what? Some days the cost may be small, but some days the cost may be great. Okay? When you begin to walk that pathway, and then things come up in your parish and say, you know what? We have a church that seats 400, but we're having like 700 people come to Mass every time. What are we going to do? People say, ah, it's a call. I respond. They don't say, you know, here's 10 bucks, good luck. Right? I respond, no matter what the cost is. Right? I mean, my house, I have 3 kids and a wife. The roof is leaking. I don't say, hey, you know what? Good luck with that. Stick up a plastic bag. No. The cost is going to be great. I may have a hard time paying that cost. But it's what I got to do. It's what I got to do. The second conviction they label as the choice. This commitment leads to a way of life, not a series of actions. You know, I always say, yes, you know, when you have stewardship activities, things like I collect coats for kids in the wintertime that don't have a coat, or cans of food for those who are hungry. Those are great things. But an atheist knows that a kid is too cold and needs a coat. And an atheist knows that someone who is hungry needs food. So the question is, what difference does it make that you and I believe in Jesus Christ and follow him? That leads to the way of life. The series of actions are important. They're not the main thing. It's how we live our life 24/7. The last conviction is, then with the first two being true, that stewardship is transformational. Stewardship is transformational. They call that the vision. The vision is of a church full of transformed people. People living this way of life and understanding that when God calls, they're ready to respond with the gifts they have been given. Right? I mean, can you imagine what that would be like? Can you imagine a full church, not just your parish, but the church in general, filled with those people? I mean, what a difference, what a difference. I mean, we all worry you make a tremendous difference, don't get me wrong. But there's so much more work that needs to be done. You know, we talked a little bit about the bishop's pastoral letter this morning, this afternoon. I just want to point out, you know, I did prepare we have a resource pack, a study guide on the bishop's pastoral letter. And it's very easy. It takes like an evening, okay? 3 short videos and a study guide. And if you're interested in that, you can buy that online. It's only $30 for your parish, you know? That's one way to implement that into programs. But you say, the point here from Charles Zeck is in every program. Well, in every program, you begin by communicating these. Okay? Are you saying that a first grader, we're going to talk about mature discipleship? I can assure you, I can talk to many a first grader who understands responding to the call, regardless of the cost, than I can a bunch of 40-year-olds. Absolutely. Absolutely. Because here's the reality. As kids are growing up, they don't always hear this. So what happens is they become adults that see life differently than this. So you can begin imparting that right from the beginning, everywhere. Provide the opportunity for lay witness presentations is number 5 on the 8 things that a parish can do. Okay? So lay witness presentations. Here's our meme. That's Felix. He is still in shock after hearing Morris tell how God transformed his life. Remember Morris the cat, right? You know, you didn't know that Morris accepted Jesus and is now practicing Catholic somewhere. The impact of witnessing is so tremendous. And hopefully for most of us that implement a yearly stewardship calendar, okay, as part of our campaigns, we have late witness talks. But here, I'm here to say there's a need for lay witnessing 12 months out of the year. One of the cornerstones in my parish, really, in terms of stewardship way of life for decades, was on the first Saturday of every month, a large group would gather in our parish hall, and a new person each month would just stand up to give their testimony. Tell people what Jesus has done for them. Right? I mean, that's important stuff. And as Catholics, we don't do enough of that because we are strengthened by each other's stories. Right? We need to hear what God is doing in each of our lives. But basically, okay, when you're choosing a lay witness, whether it be in a stewardship campaign or outside of a stewardship campaign, I've got 6 guidelines for you, right? The first one is lay witnessing is not just for stewardship campaigns. Just said that. Second one is pick the right person. Okay? Pick the right person. Because the reality is, you know, I've been in some parishes where sometimes, you know, the person giving the lay witness, I mean, they are as uncomfortable as the people listening to them. Right? And, I mean, it's like, wow, why did anyone let them put themselves in that position, right? In any community, you have a number of people who would be great lay witness speakers, okay? So pick someone who can articulate it. And not everyone's going to know how to, so you're going to help them prepare. Right? You're not going to say, hey, Joe, will you be the lay witness speaker in 2 weeks? Sure. Okay. See you on Sunday. You're not going to do that. Right? You're going to help them prepare. You're going to talk to them. You're going to have a dialogue with them about their life, about their journey. Right? You are not going to micromanage their message. You're not going to say, hey, Joe, you know what? Say this. It gets them every time. Because maybe that didn't happen to Joe, right? Because you want Joe to be sincere. You want Joe to focus on his conversion, not snapshots of before and after, right? I mean, I've heard some stewardship talks, before I da-da-da-da-da, and now I da-da-da-da-da. Thank you very much. That's great, but tell us about how that all took place. You know, where are the everyday moments that God reached in and pulled the back of your shirt and said, hey, Joe, what you doing there, man? Tell us about those. So when people are sitting in the pews, be like, oh, I felt that little tug on my collar too, right? That's the important thing, the journey. Keep it real. Keep it real. Don't be afraid to say it like it is, right? You know, if you have a lay witness speaker that has such a tremendous story, but you're like, I don't know if the community is ready for it. They're probably ready for it, you know? Their family, they're ready for it. Okay, so six guidelines. We're down to number six. We're moving right along. The sixth thing, encourage parishioners to make commitments to their parish community by pledging. Okay? So we talk about commitment cards and things like that. And Charles Zeck found, you know, in terms of like finances, right? That the number one best way of showing an increase in finances is by having people give a pledge. And that is because, for the most part, Catholics do not plan, right? They don't plan financial giving. The basket comes around and you reach into your purse for your checkbook. That's not a plan, right? So a pledge makes people think, and you're going to help them think. And before you even help them think, you're going to educate them. You're going to say, let me tell you how this whole thing works, my friend. You know, one of the things we do to our children, huge disadvantage, is we keep from them our family finances. They don't know. They don't know how much I make. They're never going to know. They don't know how much debt I'm in. No. Put it out there. Because the reality is, then they get to be an adult. Like, well, I don't know. I saw Dad doing this. I always remember Dad was pulling out that charge card. I'll just do it too, you know? They don't know. You got to keep it real, because if you don't, here comes the next meme. Do you really want me to believe that it takes that much money to keep the lights on in the church? Because I tell you what, when I was a child, every time the collection basket came along, if I asked my mother, you know, what is the offertory go to? She would say, keeps the lights on. Wow, those are some pretty expensive lights, Mom. They don't know. They don't know what it takes to keep a community running, right? Just like my children sometimes don't fully realize what it takes to keep our family running, you know? And so when you ask people to make a pledge, you're really talking to them in terms of living the vision as opposed to paying the bills. Now, this is a slide. This is about a study from the Notre Dame Institute for Church Life. It comes in three parts: the unleashing Catholic generosity, steps in the journey to becoming a more generous person, and generosity inside and outside the church. If you go to Notre Dame Institute for Church Life, you can find this, okay? Very important study, very important information for any parish. And what they found in a nutshell was, our results suggest that the American Catholic giving gap is in part a direct result of congregational culture. Catholic parishes are less likely to nurture participatory cultures compared to other Christian congregations. Parishioners are also more likely to focus on giving as paying the bills rather than living the vision. When thinking of money, Because many Catholics are more concerned with paying the bills, they lack spiritual engagement with money. The belief that proper stewardship of money is a deeply spiritual matter, which further reduces Catholic financial giving. Parishes need to find ways of moving financial giving, not as a spontaneous as able concern, but a matter worthy of conscious deliberation. People need help, and it's not just with the understanding of what do I give to my parish. They need help understanding that everything in their wallet belongs to someone else. Right? If I open up my wallet, whatever is there. And you know what? If we don't help them, then they will become enslaved to this. And then they won't be able to give to the church, and they won't be able to even give to their families. Unfortunately, it's still, even though it's getting much, much better, it's still easier to go to some programs like Financial Peace University. Who's familiar with that? Our Sunday Visitor, I think, has a financial giving program in terms of like education, like how to use your money. It's much easier to go to those in a Protestant church than it is in a Catholic church. You know, it's really, really hard to ever have a message in a church about financial giving and tithing when people misuse all of their money. All right? So as a church, we have a responsibility to help them out. This study shows that if we can communicate to them that it's a deeply spiritual manner, what they do with their money, and provide a way for them to make a plan to use their money in whatever case may be, to buy clothes for the children, buy food, to help build the new church, whatever. Okay? Essentially, we're moving people from a maintenance to mission understanding. Anyone familiar with the book Divine Renovation? The Father James Mallon. That's an awesome book, right? It's an awesome book. Because basically what he saw was, you know, hey, we're constantly in maintenance mode, right? We fix things when they get broken. We fix problems when they arise. We're not actually focusing on the mission because we spend so much time on maintenance, right? And that change basically moves people from what is wrong to what can be. You know, let's dream our scarcity of resources to truly helping people, right? I mean, I love it how sometimes going to parishes, they say, we never talk about money, never. Except you find out, can we do this? I'm sorry, we don't have the money. Well, you don't talk about money, but you do kind of talk about money because you're always telling people we don't have the money to do that, right? Okay? Scarcity of resources to helping people. Paying for programs to investing in lives. Costs to investments. Spenders into stewards, right? Cost lines into investment lines. Buildings into worship spaces. Fundraising into mission development. So in my parish, in terms of stewardship, we've eliminated the word volunteer. We've eliminated the word fundraiser. We don't raise funds. Okay? And one of the big rules in our parish is, you know, you want something to happen. We want something as a community to happen this year. Okay, we're going to put it in the budget, and we're going to take care of it. Now, will Knights of Columbus still do certain things for outside organizations? Sure. But we're not going to have every single ministry selling you brownies and popcorn and everything under the sun to fund things. We're going to put it in our budget, and as a community, we're going to meet that budget. That's what we're going to do. Father Andrew Kimberling, I love when he talks about this. I mean, he gets really, really all worked up, right? Because he'll say, you know, you do all this stuff with all your kids. You know, they're selling pizzas, they're selling popcorn, they're selling wrapping paper, you know? Basically, it's slave labor. That's what's happening. They're like, oh, look what we get. We get like 25% of this. Don't kid yourself. Don't kid yourself. That company knows what's going on, and they're making big profits off the backs of your children. So, you know, you don't need to do that, right? Let's go to number 7. Communicate with parishioners on stewardship. Well, that seems like a no-brainer. Communicate with parishioners on stewardship. I mean, if you're going to be a stewardship parish, hopefully you've told that to people, right? But it's not always so easy. Okay, you might not be able to see this one. You can see the picture. It says, if you fail to communicate effectively what stewardship is, some will go looking in the wrong places. I mean, we really sometimes fall down on communicating effectively, right? And some of the reasons why is because there's not a buy-in from everybody, right? I mean, for one, you know, parish leadership needs to buy into this. It's going to be really, really hard to bring about the stewardship way of life if your pastor's not interested in doing that. But you know what? In my parish, our current pastor, who's been there now 13 years, in the beginning, he really kind of was like, when he first came to the parish, I don't buy it. So what did we have to do? We had to tie him up and stick him in the closet. No, we didn't do that. We showed him. We didn't just teach him, we showed him. We showed him how people respond, right? He got to see how ministries flourished. He got to see how, you know, essentially, we never had to go to the community and say, hey, we don't have the funds to do this. We don't have the resources to do this. We never had to go to the community and say, gosh, we can't find people to fill these roles. We showed him. And he's like, ah, I get it. So now, when we talk about the 4 C's of stewardship communication, the first one is it needs to be constant. In every bulletin, I say every homily, every program, everywhere. I would say, and I'd be proud to say, that my pastor in some shape or form in 90% of all his homilies touches on some aspect of stewardship living. And when he does that, at least 70% of the time, he never says the word stewardship. But he repackages and remolds and reshapes the message so that people get it. And he puts forth to the community, this is what we are about. But it needs to be constant, it needs to be everywhere. It can't just be something that shows up in the 2 to 3 months of a stewardship campaign, is gone from the parish for the rest of the time, and then comes back the next year. Can't be that. If it's a way of life, it's going to be there all the time. It's going to be consistent. You're going to use the same terminology, sometimes have unifying themes. When I talk about same terminology, it means, you know what, you're going to be serious. And you're going to say, we don't talk about volunteers. Talk about stewards. Talk about people giving of their gifts. We need to be consistent. So Joe Schmo back there is going to have something with his committee, and he says, we need some volunteers. Sorry, Joe Schmo, that's not what we say here. You got to be vigilant. You got to be consistent. Okay? Unifying themes, something we do in our parish is, you know, we take months and we just say this month is going to be, we're going to focus on stewardship of prayer. We're going to focus on stewardship of talents. We're going to focus on stewardship of creation, whatever the case may be. And it really helps because then everybody, you know, thinks, well, what can I do this month? Which kind of speaks to that reality. I want to make sure I have the time because I want to share this real quick story, real short. But, you know, 1 year in the stewardship of prayer month, what I had people do, what I had the kids do in our faith formation program, I got up with the Department of Social Services or whatever the group was in our area that has kids for adoption. Without them giving me a whole lot of personal information, I got a picture and I got a first name of children seeking adoption. And I gave each and every class a picture and a name. Each kid got a copy of that. And each class made a commitment within that month to pray every single day. Each kid, every single day, for that child to be adopted. And I swear, I won't swear to God, I'm just swearing, okay? That after that month, about 6 months passed, I contact the service and I said, I need an update. I want to know what's happened with these kids. I got back that 70% of them had been adopted. So I go back to those kids in our faith formation and I say, do you understand the power of your prayer? Look what you have given to these kids, a brand new life. And what did it take you? What was the cost to you? A few minutes every night for a month. That was the power of stewardship. Concrete, clear goals, defined vision, understandable. Right? And in some parishes, we launch into, you know, stewardship is flower, 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 flower. And people are like, oh, that's really nice. What does that mean? No, let's be concrete. Let's be honest about what we're doing, right? Let's say this is what we expect. This is what we're going to do. This is what it's about, right? Talk about everyday life. Define the vision. Make it understandable for people. That's one of the reasons why I wrote the book that I have. Because it's supposed to be an everyday stewardship spirituality for everyday people, written in everyday language with reflections from everyday life. Right? You know? I talk about my kids. I talk about, you know, experiences in pop culture. I talk about all different sorts of things. People, touchstones for people. Make it understandable. Make it real. The last C is be creative. Be inventive. Be unique. Use multiple means and methods. Right? Yeah, you can steal stuff from other people, but then steal it and then, you know, make it your own. Don't be afraid to think outside the box. Make things fun. This is particularly clear at ministry fairs. Brothers and sisters of Christ, nobody likes boring ministry fairs. And that's what's happened lots of times, right? I mean, I work with this one parish, and we're like all gung-ho, gung-ho, gung-ho. And we get to the ministry fair, and they're like, guys, what? This is boring. Bunch of tables, just the whiteboards. You know what we do in my parish? We have ministry fairs. We have themes. So we have, you know, like stewardship on the boardwalk. We're all outside in the parking lot. We get big inflatables for kids to fall down. We stick, like, you know, the deacon in a dunking booth. We have all the ministries set up games, right? And then you get a little card. You get a little card. And then you have to go around all the different booths and play the game. You get your card stamped. Then you hand in your card with all the stamps. And you get a chance to win a prize, right? You know, we bring in the big stands. They've got, like, Coney Island dogs and stuff like that. That's fun. It's joy in the Lord. We're excited about asking people to give their gifts. One year, we were like, okay, we keep doing these different things. We want to do something a little bit different. Okay, we don't want to have the normal thing. And we said to people, this year, we're going to have like a ministry fair. No one's going to make a board. Because every year we have a ministry leaders luncheon, right? Each year. Basically, we tell the ministry leaders, this is what we're doing. This is the expectation. So we say, guess what? This year we're not going to make a board. They're all like, yeah! No boards. No boards. Because this is what you're going to do. It's expected that you're going to be there, and you're going to have a big sun on your shirt. Because our theme is going to be the beach. Fun at the beach. It was right after Pope Francis was elected. And so he came in and he said something like, you know, let's have a party, a birthday party for Christ, or something like that. So, okay, well, we're going to have a birthday party for him on Pentecost, but it's going to be at the beach because we're in North Carolina and we love the beach. I know you guys don't go to the beach that often in Iowa, but we love the beach. Okay? I'm going to say, party for Jesus in the cornfield. I don't know. Okay, so you got the sun here. You got a sun here and it says, hi, my name's Jack and you know what? I'm an elector, okay? The people who do things are already doing things, right? Then other people who aren't actively involved, I got a son put here. You say, okay, you know, what's something that you like doing or what are you good at? Oh, I'm Susie. I like to sing. So you walk around, hey, everyone's having a good time. And I walk up to you, oh, you like to sing? Have you ever thought about joining the choir? Well, I don't know. Well, you know, let me talk to you about it. All right? That was a different way of doing ministry fair. Be creative. Have fun. Our faith is fun. The last one. Here we go. We are in the home stretch. Remember that good stewardship starts with the parish itself. And this is so key. Right? This is so key. There's a little book put out by the ICSC many years ago in the 70s. You can still buy it today, but it's not on the website. You have to call them, I think. I absolutely love it, right? It's like spirituality of the disciple, of the good steward or something like that. But anyway, it talks about three apostolates. Okay? Three stewardship apostles. The first one is personal. You know, what we do on a personal level. You know, giving of our time and talent, treasure and things like that. The third one is everyday apostolate, you know, giving of ourselves in the ordinary life, what I call the ordinary and mundane aspects of life. That's important because that's where you get to the 100%. That's kind of what the book was all about. But the second one was communal, right? What do we do as community, right? So one of the big things in terms of stewardship, you can't ask people, you know, to give of themselves if the community doesn't give of itself, right? So it's so key. In our parish community, we have something called the We Care Committee. Every single month, different agencies and different groups from all over the area, they fill out a one-page proposal and they send it to us. And then a group of our parishioners gather and they determine how much money we can send to each of these groups. Because we're essentially tithing 10% of our total offertory to them. And then we say to our community, this is what we do. You know, this is who we are, right? And you know what? I didn't create a meme for this one. I didn't. Because there was only one image that I could put forth that I thought meant enough to really hammer home the message. I mean, the reality is, as church, called to be good stewards, called to be mature disciples, called to wash the feet of those in need. And if our parishes are about fixing holes in roofs, and only about getting more people to do stuff, and getting more money in an offertory, that's all that we're about, we will communicate nothing. We need to communicate that this is what we are about. And this is a message that is more palatable than we can understand. Because we say, well, no, we're not going to talk about this. This is a bit much. Well, instead, we're going to talk about we need more people to do stuff. Are you kidding me? That hasn't worked so well, right? No, that's not what we need. This is what we need. Because at the end of the day, the only reason, the truly only reason we practice stewardship in a parish is to lead people to Jesus Christ. Because one day our parishes will no longer be there. There will be no more dioceses. There will be no more nice stewardship conferences like this. It's going to be God and people living with Him eternally. That's what the goal is. That's why we do what we do. And if people can start to buy into that and live that way of life, then at the end of the day, we'll see those people living eternally with God. And that'll be a great thing. So thank you very, very much. I think we're going to do some question and answer really quick. Incidentally, so if you go to this, I write a blog called the Main Thing Blog, okay? And you get information there. This is where you would go to get the slides from today, okay? You'll get other resources. That's our website for LPI, and this is my email address if you want to contact me about anything. Just a chit-chat, or want to send me a funny meme. Go ahead.
I got a question over here.
Yes.
All right, Tracy, thank you very much. I really like just even how you label yourself as a director of community and engagement at the parish rather than that stewardship title.
Sure, sure.
I caught that right away. My question is what are the things that the parish can do to capture family data, to keep in touch with them about different things in their lives, or as far as birthdays, different activities? How do you capture that data and get that to the appropriate people?
Sure. Well, that's a great question. How to capture the data. There are a number of ways that you can do that. Certainly the use of technology is key, right? We can do that through, parish apps. We can start to collect data. I know LPI, we offer a parish app. We actually offer, a website that when you buy the app, when you update the app or update the website, it updates the other one, right? So on your website, you can put even like, insert this information. On your registration forms, right, your basic registration forms, too often parishes don't ask enough questions. We only want to know the real basic stuff. Is that all you really want to know? Because the reality is, if I get a registration form, you only want to know the basic stuff, you're not really indicating to me that you're really interested in me. You just want an address to send me stuff, which in most people's minds is, yeah, this is how I get envelopes. That's what people think, right? That's what they think, right? So, put stuff on there, because in terms of welcoming and hospitality, right? Really, there's nothing parishes can do that is nicer in terms of welcoming like children and things than having a list of all the birthdays and sending out birthday cards the first of the week to those kids who have birthdays, right? And that's easy to find, just having registration forms for faith formation for school. The other thing is, in terms of hospitality and knowing who people are. And I've heard this for parishes like 5, 6, 7,000 households. And the priests may cringe, but yeah, at Christmas time, everyone receives a hand-signed Christmas card. And I'll tell you what, I worked in the parish. I cannot believe it, because that's what my pastor did for years and years. Who believes that you really personally sent that to them? Come on. till I went to go visit my father. My father was in his early 80s. He came and he goes, come here, I got something to show you. Look, Monsignor sent me this. And anyone say, everyone else got the same thing, Dad. I didn't want to say that. I was going to say, that's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. You can collect data all sorts of ways using technology. I don't know if I'm answering the question that well. But, you know, basically, I mean, the key thing is, you know, when I work with parishes, I always say this in terms of registration forms. Your registration form is the key for collecting data. Now, for those people who are already there, I mean, you have, so to speak, a new census of sorts, you know? Because when we talk about having accurate data is crucial, it does mean that what's going to happen is you are going to be always actively working with the parish role. And that means sometimes you're going to have to reach out to people and say, hey, haven't seen you in like 6 months. Are you still here? And people say, whoa, aren't people going to get angry about that? Because usually, right, I mean, let's think about this. If you reach out to the person they haven't seen in 6 months, how do you know you haven't seen them in 6 months? It means they haven't put a dollar in the collection for 6 months. So like, what? You know, you want my money? That's what you think people are going to say. But invariably, what the vast majority of people say, they think to themselves, I had no idea and I was paying any attention. Because what happens in the church is what? I can register at a church, and I can just drift away for years and years. In a lot of churches, I never hear from them. I still get the DOS newspaper. I still get my envelopes that I throw in the trash can. I don't come. They're not paying any attention, you know? It's crazy. Another question? Anybody else? All the way over here. You can just shout really loud.
Yeah, it's about the question of the kindergarten being more mature disciples, kindergarten folks being more mature disciples than 40 years old.
Right, right.
It's not like, say, hard to believe. It's strange.
Press the bottom.
Sorry. Okay, it's a question from here. Question about there kindergartens. The kindergartens kids being more mature disciples than the 40-year-olds. It's not like, say, it's hard to believe. It strains credulity. Can you explain it?
Strange credulity.
Strange credulity.
Okay. I do not know what to say to that, Father.
How could kindergarten kids be more mature disciples than 40
years? Oh, well, it's not that they can be more mature. It's that they can understand the concept. I mean, if I go to a bunch of children and we talk about these issues, right? About, you know, someone's in need. You know, how are you going to respond? They're much easier to understand right off the bat. Well, I respond with whatever I can, just like that, right? I mean, you ask somebody who's, don't mean to pick on 40-year-olds, let's pick on 30-year-olds, whoever, right? You go to them, I mean, there's a hesitation sometimes, right? You say, well, wait, you know, why is the person in need? What's going on here? May I tell you what, Father Frank Connolly, who was my second pastor, okay? I mean, he amazed me. So to say there's few people that embody, you know, Jesus to me like he did. And I remember being in the parish office, and people would come in, you know, as they often would. You know what, I've just driven here from so-and-so, I need a place to stay. Now, I've been with other pastors who would say, well, you know what, you can contact Greensboro Open Ministry, you can do this, you can do that. Father Frank would say, well, I'll tell you what, I got a hotel right down the road, follow me. I'll go in and I'll pay the bill, you stay there. I thought, oh, isn't that what the Good Samaritan did? He never asked a question. And I remember thinking, half of these people, they could be taking advantage of you. He was like, nobody takes advantage of me. I choose. The reality is, someone says there's a need. Who am I to judge whether that need is real or not? I will respond. And I can honestly say, having three children, when my children were the youngest, they were most like Father Frank. You know, as we get older, that we become fearful. We become concerned about, oh, what if this? No, he just responded. So that's kind of what I was talking about. Yes?
I mean, aren't we just missing here that Jesus said you have to bring the little children on to me?
Absolutely. Like absolutely.
To reach the kingdom of
God. Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
It's gospel.
Yes. Father.
The video for the bishop's thing on stewardship.
Yes. I wish. We failed to bring those today, but you can go right at 4LPI.com, click on resources, stewardship, and it's right there.
Okay. You talked about having testimonials by laypersons. When do you do those? You said Saturday, so you're not doing them at the pulpit.
Well, I mean, that was one example of what we're doing. I mean, when we in the course of the year, we will have in our parish we'll have usually three or four within the course of the year. Two very specifically tied to the upcoming ministry fair, the upcoming stewardship commitment Sunday, but then we'll have two others at other points in time. But those would be in the church for everyone to hear at all of the masses. But the first Saturday was just an example of how you can do that additionally, right? I mean, you can do that all the time, right? You can have youth ministry, lay witness that night. You can do all sorts of things. The whole point was the more we talk about our faith and share our faith journey, the more we uplift one another. Okay. Thank you.